Welcome everyone. I'm Kushagra Patwa, CSO, Encircle Tech, and I am your guide for this journey. In a galaxy not so far, far away, COVID-19, the pandemic spread of COVID-19 has literally shut down the world. The financial impact is going to be worse than what happened in 2007. Organizations around the globe will be forced to learn new ways and adapt. The silver lining to this crisis will be organizations that will be fit and agile, adopting to smart workflow automation. That's where machine learning comes in, from increase in efficiency to capability augmentation. We know its advantages. To apply the same in engineering and design across AEC and manufacturing, the hope lies with our Jedi Order, led by our host Varun Bhartiya, co-founder and CEO Encircle Tech, and our guest Bharti Ganesh, CTO from Arnex Solutions. May the force of machine learning be with you.
Thank you, Kushagra. Welcome everyone, and special thanks to Bharti for joining us today. Bharti, I personally see machine learning as a natural technological progression. However, there is quite a few across our circle of clients, prospects, and employees who find it difficult to determine if the force of machine learning is really instrument of Sith or force of light used by the Jedi. In your own personal opinion, do you think ML-powered machines will replace humans, and eventually, just like Terminator, Skynet will replace humans and take over the world?
Thank you, Varun. I would also like to thank Encircle Tech on behalf of Arnex Solutions for making this event feasible despite the COVID-19. Though we all are working from home, the acceleration in software as well as hardware made this event possible and virtually connected with us with the audience. As we quickly adapt to these changes, it's time for everyone to adapt to the changes happening with respect to AI. Now, coming back to the point, I'm actually glad that you have asked about the conspiracy that has been alive for the last decade. I just remembered a class, History Repeats Itself. The active AI research started around the 1950s and the conspiracy started in 1970s itself. Stanford Research Institute developed a robot named Shaky in 1972, which has the capability of moving the boxes autonomously. It was the moment where the active conspiracy started by quoting, "Will the AI take the place of humans?" And it was quoted by an applied mathematician from Cambridge University. As we all know, the acceleration happening over hardware and software increased the productivity of the workforce to better serve humankind. The same is applicable for AI also. So in my observation, from the 1970s to present, these fears are more a byproduct of resistance to technology change and transformation that any new technology issues in. To put it simply, the evolution of AI will accelerate the workforce rather than replacing it.
I agree, Bharti. Every new automation has opened up more opportunities for everyone. The requirement of skill set perhaps will change, but there is always a lot more to do with newer technology. Now that we have addressed the elephant in the room, without further ado, let's get into first part of our webinar, the what part of it. So in this section, we are going to talk about the basic terminology, artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, different techniques used in this domain, algorithms, as well as look at some of the industry trends. So Bharti, in my observation, there are many people who use all these three terms, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and deep learning, quite interchangeably. So could you please enlighten us with the differences between these three terms, and what are the similarities and differences among them?
Sure, Varun. In simple, deep learning is a subset of machine learning, and machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence. Let me try to describe them. As well as we all know, AI is one of the fastest growing emerging technologies. Artificial intelligence means to replicate the activities of natural intelligence, mimicking the way of human brain thinks, works, and functions. We are not able to establish a proper AI till now, but we are actually progressing towards it. You might have heard about Sophia, one of the most advanced social humanoid robot present today. You have to believe that the robot has the ability to display more than 60 facial expressions. Even Sophia became the Saudi Arabian citizen. the first robot to receive citizenship of any country. Machine learning is the way of achieving AI, which basically means by the use of machine learning, we may be able to achieve certain objectives of AI. Autonomous cars is one such objective, an AI solution, but ML algorithms are the actual drivers. Deep learning is a subset of machine learning. It includes a task-specific algorithm that makes use of deep neural networks that are specifically inspired by the structure and functions of the human brain. Its enhanced capabilities over the conventional machine learning algorithms accelerates the researchers to make progress towards human-level AI. The reason is, if a conventional machine learning model returns an inaccurate prediction, then the program needs to fix that. But in the case of deep learning, the model does it by itself. So to sum it up all, deep learning is machine learning and all machine learning is artificial intelligence, but the same doesn't hold true vice versa.
Thank you, Bharti. I think that explains and gives our viewers some reference to how artificial intelligence, machine learning and deep learning are different from each other and at the same time subset of each other. So with this, let's look at some of the industry trends. Is industry really adopting artificial intelligence and machine learning, or is it just a buzzword? To share some data points, it is estimated that in year 2021, artificial intelligence related automation will generate a business value of about $2.9 trillion. $2.9 trillion, people, that's huge. And I would also like to focus upon the industries as an construction industry, which is a subset of all the industries taken together. This construction industry contributes to automation using machine learning in the range of about $500 million dollars in current year, and by year 2021, about $1 billion. This industry is expected to grow at an average of about 34 CAGR. Beyond this, let's try to look at whether only large-scale enterprises are investing into machine learning, or even the startups are investing into machine learning and reap the benefits of automation. To give you an example, a tech startup, Doxel, has an AI-based system that makes use of robotics and LiDAR technology to collect data from the construction site and provide meaningful insights to the engineer. Using this technology, a construction company was able to reduce the construction budget by 11% and increase the productivity by 38%. I would also like to talk about our partner Autodesk, which introduced Construction IQ. Construction IQ is an AI service that works with Autodesk BIM 360 project management platform. Construction IQ, a machine learning model, has been trained over 30,000 building projects. It takes data from classic BIM 360 field and the next generation field management and account management modules. Then applies analytical techniques and machine learning to transform the data into simple and actionable insights. Very helpful for the industries where the demand is super high going forward. So like this, there are many examples from the industry which have invested and created awesome solutions for the industry. To name few more, Build Robotics and SmartBuild IO. Of course, I expect a lot of our viewers from this webinar today to create this machine learning based solutions for the future.
Fair enough point, Varun. From just a supplemental tool to engineering, today it is a fundamental part of the daily workflow. That is the present and future of machine learning as well. I believe despite the domain expertise, knowledge about the AI becomes an essential skill set. Being an AI researcher, I'm also happy to see the initiatives in investments from the AAC in ML research.
That was very nicely put, Varun and Bharti. Now let's move on to the meaty section, the question that is burning in the hearts of our viewers. when to use machine learning? Are there any specific parameters to keep in mind before deciding on machine learning as the optimal technique for solving a problem?
It's very interesting question, Kushagra. And I think many companies struggle with this problem statement. They often tend to use machine learnings for wrong problems and then realize very late in the process whether machine learning solution is really helping us or it has sucked us into an endless cycle of development. So to help our viewers, we have identified some primary causes which leads to failure of machine learning solutions. First would be wrong problem to solve. Not every problem is the best problem for machine learning. Sometimes you have very clearly defined rules and sometimes you have very different expectations. So it is very important to determine what problem is apt for machine learning. Then there are cases with related to misaligned expectations. For example, for some problems, you are expecting almost mission critical accuracy, which is very high accuracy. Whereas in some other cases, you're just trying to assist the designer or an engineer. So it is important to realize or ask ourselves what level of an accuracy is expected from the system. Likewise, the availability of data. Every one of us knows machine learning is heavily dependent on the availability of data. Along with availability of data, it is the quality of data that is also very important. When all of these parameters are thoroughly thought about, we can decide whether it is a good problem to solve or not. To further make it easy for everyone, we have come up with a three-step approach to plan an implementation of ML-based solution. In this three-step framework, we first talk about feasibility analysis. Again, here it is about type of problem and availability of quantity as well as quality of the data. Then we talk about intuition fitment, what kind of algorithm within machine learning is best for such a solution. And third, of course, is about expectation setting. So again, very simple three steps: feasibility analysis, intuition fitment, and expectation setting. Let's dive deeper into feasibility analysis. Machine learning is typically used for projects that involve predicting an output and uncovering trends. So there are, first of all, we look at the problem and ask ourselves, do we, by the technological advancement or just research, do we already know certain rules which are easy to code by a new rule? If the rules are straightforward, probably a traditional programming can really solve that problem without really getting into machine learning, and perhaps can even do a better job at it. But when it's dependent on too many factors and the variable and rules overlap with each other, I think it becomes humanly impossible to write a straightforward code in the traditional manner. So I know what are spam emails, what are the sentiment of emails, and so on. Then we talk about the pure learning versus automation with learning. It is very important to distinguish between pure automation problem and automation with learning problems. Machine learning can help automate your process, but not all automation problems require learning. Automation without learning is appropriate when problem is relatively straightforward. You have a clear predefined sequence of steps and controlled inputs from another machine, then traditional automation would work. On the other hand, if the inputs have a lot of variation and the system needs to constantly learn from the experience, I think machine learning is a better solution. So to give you an example, completely automated trains are possible and have been around for quite some time. The parameters of variation are very less. Trains are going to run on specific track. There is start time and end time. Very simple problem statement. But when it comes to a self-driving car, the variation, just the variation of inputs is too high. You can have people driving around with not following certain rules, whether the speed limits or the signals, even the road crossings. And hence, it becomes too complex a problem to be coded by a human. At the same time, it requires a lot of learning with every experience, possible accident, and then improvise. So such problems are best suited for machine learning. Lastly, it is very important to understand the quality and quantity of data.
So for learning, data becomes crucial. And I am assuming more and more data, and that too with good quality, will be key here.
Absolutely, Kushagra. Machine learning at its core is a set of statistical methods meant to find patterns. These methods are great at determining how certain features of the data are related to the outcomes. Keep in mind that statistical methods do not bring to table intuition, theory, or the domain knowledge of human analyst. So AI tends to make wrong decision on the basis of wrong data sets. The problem in AI implementation emerges when data is incorrect or incomplete. In short, not prepared to fit into the AI model. So it is very important to have processed and refined data which system can use and analyze to really draw best conclusions. Now, let's look at the same things in simple table. You may have in your industry about four different problems that you think are apt for machine learning. You put them through this framework of four parameters, whether simple rules are available or not. So is it possible to code using simple rules or not? Whether a human can really comprehend all such data or not, and automation with learning, does the system constantly need to learn from the experience, and quantity and quality of data. If you start marking each of your problem statements across these four parameters, you will realize that out of many, many problems, you will land up with, let's say, two or more problems that are apt for machine learning based on these four parameters. The next stage would be to really understand what is the time and cost involved in the process. So on the next slide, we do this regular comparison of impact of the problem statement or the solution and the investment required. You would put all the problems in four different quadrants and it will help you pick out the best solution. Don't worry, on the investment part, time and cost, experts such as NCircle and RNet can really help you come up with quick numbers so that your decision making can be accelerated. So with all this, give you what kind of problem is best for machine learning. Once we have the best problem that is best for machine learning, we need to evaluate few more things before we actually embark on the development. So Bharti, would you like to talk about a few next steps?
Sure, Varun. In fact, to really test the feasibility of the problem, it is advisable to develop a use case or MVP. One of the best things about AI technology is that it is very fairly easy to create a base level version of a solution by using humans or MVP. The benefit of this is not just easy analysis of a solution, but also within a time guarantee that the product actually needs an AI solution. The next steps of intuition analysis and exploration settings in framework go hand in hand. Let's start with the intuition fitment test. Machine learning outcomes are probability in nature, not the possibility. So before getting in, get yourself comfortable with how the method actually works. Does the intuition of the methodology roughly make sense? Does it fit conceptually in your larger product or framework? What makes this method especially well suited to your problem? Based on the answer to this question, we should choose the best fit ML method. We have fixed the algorithm to learn. Now what's the next? Expectation alignment. The root cause of challenges of AI in business often emerges because of heightened short-term expectation from a technology which inherently operates in a long-term mode. For an example, in an autonomous car, before reaching the objective of reaching the driverless state, the process has to go through multiple stages to assist the driver. Eliminating the physical activities required by the driver, like foot and hand activities, and eliminating the cognitive activities happening through the eyes and mind. So these are the intermediate stages. This kind of staging also helps in collecting quantitative and qualitative data for automation with learning. Next instance of misaligned expectation can be seen in businesses, assuming their AI-based solution will be accurate enough to meet different perceptions. Once you ask enough questions and receive enough concept to an initiative understanding of how the methodology works, you will see that it is far from magical. The machine learning prediction engine will get things right on average, but will reliably make mistakes.
So help me understand. Are you saying that mistakes will happen, and they will happen most often in ways that one cannot anticipate?
Yes, Kushagra. Hence, the last step is evaluate the extended to which you can allow for expressions or statistical error in your process. In the medical field, if you cannot allow even 1% of error, are you happy in getting things right? Is 80% is enough? Can you deal with the 10% of error rate, 5% or 1%? Are there certain kinds of error that should never be allowed? Be clear and upfront about your needs and expectations. Once you have gone through these steps, you are ready to successfully execute and develop your ML-powered solutions and reap great benefits.
Well, that was effective yet elegant. And now that we have seen the what and when of machine learning, we would like to culminate this episode with a case study demonstration. Recently, along with Vectorworks, we started developing a predictive solution, a predictive UI solution rather, and how we use this framework of ours to reach the implementation stage of predictive UI. So Varun, please, the stage is all yours.
So it is well known fact in that CAD software now have thousands of commands, and oftentimes the user is not able to figure out the best, locate the specific command that he's interested in. And oftentimes he does not know the best way to do certain operations. So it is important to take advantage of collective intelligence from thousands of users across the globe. So problem statement is, can we assist the designer during the design process by providing the tools that designer is most likely to use the next? So our partner Vectorworks asked us if this is a good problem to solve using machine learning. As you can see in the table, we evaluated it across all four parameters of our framework. Are there any specific rules? Very difficult to determine because there are different persona of the users, different roles, and probably no clear definition of what they are going to use next. Can we comprehend the patterns manually? No. The scale of data is so large that it is humanly impossible to comprehend all that data. Automation with learning, with ever-changing designs and ever-changing software as well, it is important to for the system to constantly learn from the experience. It is almost like training an assistant along with you, who is going to always assist you in your job. And at the same time, it is very important to have the right data. But with all the analytics in place, we collect large quantities of data though anonymously, which can be used to then train the machine learning model for predictive outcomes. So after we checked off all these four parameters, we also work with Vectorworks to provide them with investment in terms of time and cost, which happily landed predictive UI in the first quadrant, which is low investment and a very high impact. That made it almost straightforward for us to go ahead and see how machine learning can be implemented for this problem statement. So, Bharti, please do the honors of explaining next steps of our framework.
Sure, Varun. There is a statistics that 90% of the time we only use 10% of the comments. But the combination of these 10% of comments makes n finite patterns. Human behavior is not a linear process. So it is hard to fix rules for these n finite numbers of patterns. In the human machine interface, the dynamic interface changes as the user works day in and day out, as opposed to a static one tailored for a particular use. That is where AI comes in, especially the deep learning algorithms. It collects data and then predicts what UI is best for the context and the user, changing the learning as needed. For example, in design completion, when picking an edge to fillet or a chamfer, the AI algorithms look at other edges that are similar to symmetric or of a comparable length or located nearby and predicts what other edges you are likely to select. Add another manual selection as the feature to make the refined prediction. If you agree with the prediction, one tap gives you the go-ahead and the designer assistant automatically picks all the suggested edges. What we did is, we started learning what kinds of models people had been creating with it and how they created those models. After a while, the AI learns to predict what you're going to do. It looks at the step. It knows what you have gone through. And it is able to analyze and says, I think you are making one of these objects. And it understands the steps you need to take to get to the chain. The adaptive UI will predict the comments that you will most likely to want to use based upon the context. Then what you are going to do at the moment. It will put these recommended comments in a clean and compact panel to speed up you through the workflow. The panel will reflect differently based upon the each user's unique style of usage. We can predict from the previous behavior what the next set of behavior will be. We are not relying on the customer to do the customization. We are learning and dynamically adjusting the UI on the fly. You can map it with the type ahead in Google search boxes or mailboxes. As you type, it suggests additional phrases. These suggestions are learned from the history of the search made by the people. The result is the outcome of collective intelligence rather than the individual intelligence.
Thank you. Thank you, Bharti, for taking us in so much depth. That really allowed us to understand how the solution was built. So if I can recollect correctly, the last part before we kickstart the development is setting the right expectations from a solution. So Varun, how did you define the expectation for yourself and for Vectorworks for developing the predictive UI solution?
So expectation setting is very important for deciding the outcome of any machine learning solution. Like Bharti earlier suggested, we have to pay a close attention to accuracy expected out of this solution. So we ask ourselves two important questions. Is it very, very critical for machine learning solution to identify the next tool that is going to be used by the engineer or designer, and how accurate is that required? So answer was simple. It is okay if you predict not one, but probably next possible five commands which designer is likely to use. And at the same time, is it okay if there are errors in prediction? What happens if all these five tools are not the tools that user is likely to use? The answer was it is a fair outcome. We just want to assist the user probably 70-80% of the time and still get assist him in the design process to accelerate the design process. So in short, it is important to understand that predictive UI will not produce 100% accurate predictions, but it will generate 5 or 10 most likely commands for the user and thus accelerate the design process. This entirely led us to conclude that predictive UI is a good solution, I mean, problem statement to be solved using machine learning. And that's how we embarked on this journey.
That was quite insightful. And I think, thank you to Vectorworks for, I think, providing us with this opportunity to work with them. Thank you once again, Varun and Bharti. I learned a lot and I believe our viewers are feeling the same. I would like to inform our viewers that our next episode of this webinar series will be focusing on how to apply machine learning in manufacturing in AEC. So essentially, whatever we learned till now, now that will be put into application. So gear up for the next episode. Here's a small teaser for what to expect in our next episode. Right from talking about, you know, where manufacturing and AEC stands with respect to the average rise in world GDP and hence the potential in ML adoption in each of them. We'll be also talking about the barriers that you will see in terms of in these industries to adopt a machine learning. We'll also be talking about the challenges being faced by professionals in in these industries and how they impact across the different stages of the conveyor belt. Ultimately, we'll also talk about the solutions throughout the pre-construction, construction, and post-construction phase for AEC, as well as across the whole conveyor belt for manufacturing as well. We will also touch upon some marquee ML solutions that we have developed in-house for AEC and manufacturing. Before we move on to Q&A, what I'll be doing is essentially now the ML fitment framework that we promised all of you before joining for the webinar, we will be putting it up for download for the next 30 seconds. At the same time, I'll also start the Q&A session as well. So please, everyone, feel free to download the fitment report. And at the same time, this is the time. Please let us know your questions, and we will start throwing them at our hosts for the evening. At the same time, please do understand we are running on limited time, so we'll be taking limited amount of questions. But please be rest assured, all the questions missed will be answered personally by Varun and Bharti directly through into your inbox.
So we have our first question from John, which is, for the predictive UI, what kind of commands do you include in the previous behavior of the user? So what you are trying to ask here is what kind of commands are used in the predictive UI analysis. So I think every past action of the user is very, very critical in the decision-making process. There are analyses that are done like 2 consecutive events, 5 consecutive events, up to 10 consecutive events, which can lead us to predict what user is more likely to do next. At the same time, it is also important to understand the context. Sometimes user might be too zoomed in into a drawing, and then the choices of toolkits that he may require will be far different versus when he is zoomed out. He could be sometimes in a particular rendering mode, and the choices of toolkits required would be very different, whereas in some other rendering mode, it would be very different. So, this is still under development process, but I hope it gives you a fair sense of different kinds of events that are taken into consideration when deciding the predictive UI.
So I think we ordered, we answered the question asked by John. I think, and John, if you have any other doubts, we can definitely connect offline as well. For the next question, we have machine learning as a service is being used in organizations like Amazon, IBM, Google. What do you see in terms of CAD and BIM, the scope of the same?
Like all of these organizations, I think there is a lot of scope for various application in CAD and BIM, which can become software as a service. For example, scan to BIM solution. These days, there's huge spike in the number of scans that are happening using drones, robots. We just saw things about Doxel. So number of scans are just increasing, and it is very difficult to manage large point cloud data. So imagine a service which consumes point cloud as an input and outputs a BIM model by processing all the point cloud data, identifying every entity, and actually modeling a BIM model, creating a BIM model out of the point cloud using machine learning. From manufacturing sector, similarly, there could be an example of feature recognition. You upload a part file and it does a feature recognition analysis, which can then be utilized for cost estimation. Such services can be easily integrated into any platform and enable various online cloud systems to make informed decisions based on the data generated.
Thank you, Sean. I think that was a very relevant question to ask. And please, if any other questions are there, please do connect with us. The next question is essentially about choosing the right algorithm. How do we choose the right algorithm? Are there any factors involved in algorithm shortlisting? This comes from JJ from London.
Yeah. Thanks for that question. Actually, we cannot end up with the selection of a single algorithm. In fact, all the algorithms have their own merits and demerits based on the performance. When you say performance, that includes learning capability, like to produce like 100% accuracy or 80% accuracy, and it has its own execution time, like it takes some 2 to 3 months for training or 1 day for training, and the inference time. But we can filter out the algorithms which are not suitable based on the quantity and quality of the data, input and output features, types, and etc. For an example, like when your input has a sequence of data coming in and sequence of data coming out, so at that time you have to go for a sequential based learning. So you can include a long short-term memory networks and deep neural, like RNN algorithms. So those are few algorithms we can use. But when you go for a single instance, you can go for a typical deep neural network model, a CNN-based classification. So they like that, you can actually take it. But last but then not least, the algorithm selection will be based on the experience of the AI practitioner handling the same or the similar objective.
Fair enough, Bharti. I think that should clear the doubt of JJ. JJ, again, thank you so much for the question. We have another question, essentially, which is talking about the application of machine learning and AI in AEC industry. It's still in its very initial stages. How do you think AI and ML can revolutionize the AEC industry? Varun, would you like to answer this question?
Sure. So I think AEC, as we discussed, is really very under automated industry, and some of my data points suggest that we have to build probably 13,000 buildings a day to support the population by 2050. To really understand how machine learning can revolutionize the AEC industry, I think it can help companies bid faster on the projects based on all the data that has been collected from the past bids and all the variations. It can help in prevention of cost overshoot and risk mitigation. It can really predict any kind of safety issues that are likely to happen during the construction. It can help in better sequencing and scheduling of the construction process. And really addressing one of the crucial problems, which is availability of skilled laborers. So it is probably very much required that skilled laborers are required in the industry. If machine learning is able to address all of these, and I'm confident that it will be, I think it can really revolutionize the AEC industry.
Thank you, Varun, for answering that in such a depth. I think K would be happy with the answer. Again, Kate, thank you so much for asking this question. And please do not hesitate to write to directly to Varun and Bharti to take this ahead. The last but not the least question, I think, Bharti, I'll throw the same to you. What we are talking about is how do we distinguish between relevant and non-relevant data? Are any domain experts required, or do we use machine learning here?
Yeah, that was actually a quite good question. It basically depends upon the objective. So consider that we have a history of temperature value at a particular location. Now you want to predict the current temperature, means that we can actually do it because we already have the relevant data, like the past 1 year or the past couple of years data, we already have it in our desk. But now we want to predict the current humidity. Still we can do it because the temperature has a direct relation with the humidity. But if you want to predict the rainfall at the same location, means you can't do it because the data is actually non-relevant. So that's how we are making the segregation between the relevant and non-relevant. But you can actually observe that when you actually predicting the humidity from the temperature data, you need a subject matter expert who actually defines that rules. So that is the role for subject matter expert or the domain expert, like in a ML solutioning.
Thank you, Bharti. I think, guys, we still have few questions pending, but in the interest of time, we'll be wrapping up this webinar. Please, again, as I mentioned, all the questions asked by our viewers will be answered personally by Varun and Bharti. Once again, thank you, Varun and Bharti, for taking us through this invigorating fireside chat version of this webinar. Thank you to all our viewers for taking time out of their busy schedule and asking such insightful questions. We were truly delighted to and we hope that we could answer most of them in an effective way. Also, we would be sharing the recording of this webinar along with a feedback form. Please do let us know what you truly felt about this webinar so that we can keep getting better for the next episode and so on and so forth. Also, for people who missed downloading the ML Fitment form, yes, there will be few of them. We'll be sending it straight into your inbox as well. We hope and pray that all of you stay safe. See you soon, and may the force of machine learning be with you and empower the world to do more and better with less.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for attending the webinar. It was wonderful audience. We really enjoyed it. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.